It's the queen from Queens with the money.
Hey guys, this is your girl Paula, the queen from Queens. These are Money Minutes That Matter. It's a talk show where people call in with financial questions and I give them financial answers. On this show, we become accountable to each other. This person coming on during our conference makes me a better person. He is my best friend. We have been dating since 1989. We are the parents of four beautiful adult children. And this is his segment. And I asked him to bring the history back. When I was in school, I didn't know that I was a descendant of the slaves. Why? Because who wanted to be a slave? Who wanted to be the one who was weak? Who wanted to be the one who was being dominated? No one wanted to associate with that, but we need to know our history. African American history is rich history. We need to know it from a positive perspective. So I asked my best friend, Hugh Roberts, to bring us that information, to talk to us about what we had prior to being colonized, what we had prior to the gun coming onto the continent of Africa. Mansa Musa was incredible. At our house, my husband loves history. He watches the History Channel, watches PBS. He watches how things are made. And as an aerospace engineer by degree and an IT professional by practice, this brother knows his stuff. And that's why I fell in love with him, very honestly, because he's a person who sets goals for himself. He doesn't accept the status quo. From the day that I met him, he told me, there's nothing impossible. There's nothing I can't do. And he's demonstrated that over and over and over in all these decades. Listen to our story, bridging the history generation by generation.
For that warm introduction, as I attempt to share some insight into who we are, our past, and tie things together, hopefully for us even better. Antoine showed a great slide on the great leader, Mansa Musa. And I'll touch into that as we get further into generation connections. Who are we? Where did we come from? Where are we going? So many questions, so few answers. I'll take us back in time to the year 600 BC. There's an empire called the Ghana Empire. Not Ghana as we know today, but an empire built for kings and queens so that we could show our talents in developing wealth, in ruling and managing our people. This empire was located in Africa. It encompasses area of of Mali, Mauritania, and other countries in the western part of Africa. As you can see, I've shown some clips here of some of the artifacts that were found in that region of gold, ivory, and also you can see here, gold is still prevalent in that region. We had a rich culture that showed dance, that showed our strengths as we continue to grow and develop as a nation and as a culture. We were wise. The Ghana Empire taxed the traders that came and brought in goods and also taxed them on what they took out. In addition, after the fall of the Ghana Empire, another empire rose, the Mali Empire. The Mali Empire started around the 12th century BC to the 16th century BC. Here, it was started by Sudeta Keita, the first ruler, who was named the Lion Prince. Again, in the similar region, the territory included Guinea, Mali, Senegal, Gambia, Mauritania, Nigeria, Guinea-Bissau. They control the trade routes from the north, from the Arabs across the desert into Western Africa. Here's a depiction that was drawn in the 13th century in 1375 in Spain by a map maker depicting Mansa Musa as he traveled to visit Cairo in 1324 BC. It is said that he spent and simply gave away so much gold that the price of the bullion crashed by 20%. Such riches set off a never-ending round of rumors that Mali was a kingdom paid with gold. In addition, the Mali Empire spearheaded the development of learned environments. Today, we can see some of the artifacts from the Mali Empire that are still in existence. Here we see a mosque made from wood and pounded earth in Dehenni, Mali. The empire also was one of the first to create a charter of human rights. I show a depiction of a ruler that depicts Mansa Musa in the first half of the 13th century. He, in the Mali Empire, developed an army numbering over 100,000 men and included an armored cavalry corps of 10,000 horses. Learned schools include and taught history, geography, astronomy, mathematics, and medicine. Great libraries were built, up to 10,000 of books and manuscripts, much of which survive today in Timbuktu. So we built, we owned, we ruled, we governed, we produced, we conquered. We all remember the story of Hannibal the Great that conquered part of Spain and Italy. We wrote, we sung, we painted, and we sculptured, and we also worshiped. Africans in America, our transition to America. It was by great surprise for me to discover that this artifact was found right here in the Americas. Who does it look like? Look at the nose and the lips. This artifact was found in Mexico. It is in the museum in Mexico that there is no undisputed scientific proof that the first Americans were descended from Africans or Australian Aborigines. Cave paintings found in Mexico provide the first clue to the African-looking people who we now call Olmecs. So I want to give you a perspective of what I just went over in terms of a timeline. In 1302 BC, we had the birth of Pharaoh Ramses II. During that time frame, the Olmecs were in Americas. In 55 BC, Rome invades Britain. And we all know in 1 AD, the birth of Christ. The Ghana Empire spans 600 to 1300 AD. The Mali Empire spanned 1200 AD to 1600 AD, and a time frame when the Black Plague in the year 1337 occurred in Europe. After the Black Plague, we know from our history books that Europe experienced its renaissance. That was at the same time the Mali Empire was prospering in Africa. Have you heard of that in your history books? One of the things that was discovered were that the scripts found on the monuments were Mendi scripts and has been deciphered and found to be identical to the Mendi scripts used in West Africa. Another thing I discovered is Africans were in Europe, even in the Middle Ages. We were called the Moors. The Moors lived in Spain, Portugal, and other parts of Europe. This picture that was painted in the 15th century depict a Moor riding on a horse in the middle of a square. Moors were royals and nobles and ruled and lived in Europe during the 15th century, during the time that we've seen not much of our about us in history.
Old pirates, yes, they robbed.
We now move to the year 1619, August 20, 1619, when 20 plus Angolans kidnapped by the Portuguese arrived on a ship
from the
San Juan Bautista in Port Comfort, Virginia. Journey began about 300 began with about 350 enslaved Africans, but lost most to hunger and death through the passage. That journey led to what we see here as the transatlantic slave trade. Between the year 1501 to 1875, you can see that some 12.5 million of our ancestors were transported to the Americas, to South America and North America, and the Caribbean. And as you can see some of those numbers, it is astounding how many of us were transported and survived that journey across the Atlantic. Most of the slaves are our ancestors were taken from West Africa, from Sierra Leone, Benin, now in countries today, Nigeria, Ghana, Guinea-Bissau, Guinea. But as you can see, this map depicts during that same time frame, 1501 to 1875, where a number of our ancestors came from to the West. Now I want to touch on something that was occurring when the individuals were migrating over to the Western world from Europe. A lot of Europeans came as indentured servants. And what indentured servants entail was that in order to pay for your trip, you would sign an agreement to work for someone for a set number of years, usually 7 to 10. And at the end of their contracts, they receive freedom dues of food, clothing, and maybe even a parcel of land. Most of the indentured servants were of Irish, Scottish, English, and German descent. But I did notice that, as you saw earlier, there were Africans that were in Europe at that time that did arrive as indentured servants and gained their freedom through this passage. African or Moors from Europe arrived in early America. But at the same time, slaves were being brought over, and something occurred that changed the perspective of how we were described and our ancestors were described. It was called the Beacon Rebellion of 1676. That saw poor whites and African indentured servants unite to form a rebellion against their masters. Immediately after that rebellion, Virginia lawmakers began to make legal distinction between white and black inhabitants. By permanently enslaving Virginians of African descent and giving poor white indentured servants and farmers some new rights and status, they hoped to separate the two groups and make it less likely that they would unite again in rebellion. This was the first time in the Oxford Dictionary that was printed in 1671 that the adjective white was used in reference to a white man, a person of race distinguished by a light complexion. So over time, between 1650 and 1705, several laws were put in place that were called the slave codes that prohibited African descendants from owning arms and ammunition, the status of a child when they were born, and what they were defined as. Whether you were a Christian or not a Christian at the time of your arrival led to a certain status. If you were not a Christian, you were considered a slave. So these laws radically changed and created what we saw in our history as the slave codes. I include a depiction of one of our founding fathers, George Washington, that I found. This is a painting of him dated in 1851 of George Washington as a farmer at his Mount Vernon estate. As you can see, this is slaves in the background, which are our ancestors, and the children in the bottom left playing in the fields. Slavery was a state-sanctioned institution, effectively written into Article 1 of the U.S. Constitution. It was ingrained in the way the country was formed. Now we have heard of the Indian Trail of Tears, but we also had the Slavery Trail of Tears. This is a painting that depicted slaves that were being marched from the Tobacco South to the Cotton South. Millions of slaves were taken from Virginia West, which is West Virginia roughly, into Tennessee around the time frame of 1850. This drawing or painting, it can be found in the Colonial Williamsburg Rockefeller Folk Art Museum in Williamsburg, Virginia. This picture depicted America during the middle 1700s. And I play this song in the background because in order to gain our freedom, we had to fight. And fight we did. Several revolts occurred where our descendants took up arms and fought for their rights and their lives. A few I'll mention is the revolt of New York in 1712 that saw 23 African American slaves took up arms and killed several white owners in the community. The Stonewall Rebellion of 1739 in South Carolina saw about 20 slaves under the leadership of a man named Jemmy, who was from Angola, took up arms and again battled for their freedom. Again in New York, in 1741, one of the largest revolts occurred where 1,700 blacks living in the city burned the governor's house and burned several other buildings in the city before being all caught, convicted in a short trial, and many were hanged and burned for their act. So you can see Africans in America did earn their freedom. They did own and build. We rebelled. And again, our ancestors survived the passage, family separation, long work hours, harsh environment, cruelty and inhumane treatment, and cultural destruction. Some of the pictures in the background depict what I found that was some of the treatment that was dispensed on us just for being disobedient or not obliging our master's wishes. Slavery, a system of inherent cruelty. If they did not, we would not be here today. If they did not survive, we would not be here today. So African Americans, how did we get here? The Slavery Abolition Act of 1833 that was passed in England abolished slavery in most of the British colonies, freeing more than 800 enslaved Africans. But this did not apply to America. We had to fight a civil war to gain our freedom because America was no longer under British rule. This picture depicted a corps of African Americans that were fighting during the Civil War at Seven Pines, Fair Oaks, Virginia. A photograph of these men around the cannons that they were using in battle. Take a look at our soldiers. These are our descendants. The Emancipation Proclamation of 1863 allowed black men to serve in the army, but not serve with the same rights. Black troops were paid significantly less than their white counterparts. White privates made $13 a month and had their uniforms paid for by the army. Black soldiers earned $10 a month, and $3 was deducted from that $10 to pay for their uniforms. So in essence, they earn only $7 a month for their participation. But we kept persisting until the 1960s when we started and had the civil rights movement that led to the enacting of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which was the nation's premier civil rights legislation. We're all familiar that it outlawed discrimination on the basis of race, color, religion, sex, and national origin. Further led to the election of the 44th President of the United States, Barack Hussein Obama, the first African-American president to hold such office. His father, Barack Sr., a Kenyan economist, met his mother while they were in school, in college, studying in Hawaii. But 2021, where are we today? I took an excerpt of an article that I found online that displayed the discussion between a police officer and his commander in Hamilton, Georgia. And I point your eyes to the bottom where a statement was made that I know there were a lot of them mistreated. I don't have any doubts about that. But for the most part, it seems to me like they furnished them a house to live in. They furnished them clothes to put on their backs. They furnished them food to put on the table. And all they had to do was work. And now we give them all those things and they don't have to work. I leave the explicit out. But in a sense, as you saw from some of my presentation, and you could see more as you do your research, that was not the case. The houses that most slaves live in were made of log and mud to fill the gaps, thatched roofed. It did not retain heat. And again, mud floors. And multiple families live within a home. Men, women, and children work 6 days of the week and only getting Sunday off to worship and care for their family. We ate the scraps that were given to us. Clothes lasted for years, usually only having one or two sets, one for work, one for church. We had no medicines for our sickness. 2013 saw a new movement, Black Lives Matter movement, started after the acquittal of George Zimmerman, after his shooting of African-American teen Trayvon Martin. That demonstration spread around the world. Some of the countries I've highlighted here. But as Antoine touched on earlier, I just had to reiterate in my presentation that the median wealth between black and white households between 1989 and 2019 is such that white households accounted for 60% of the US population, but held 84%, $94 trillion of the total household wealth in the US. Black households, on the other hand, we account for 13.4% of the U.S. population, but we only hold 4%, $4.6 trillion of total household wealth. Opportunity abound. Know the game after playing it for over 400 years. We can change the narrative. I just want to highlight something to you. Africa today produced 22% of the world's total gold production. Africa today produced 55% of the diamonds in the world. We produce platinum, cadmium, lithium, uranium. Africa is still losing its resources today, not only human capital, but natural resources. Highlight a few pictures. This is a beach in Ghana, Coconut Grove, Ghana, that you would never really think existed here. You would think this is somewhere in the Caribbean. This is a city. Where? In Accra, Ghana, a town where you see Toyota Corollas and RAV4 driving around. Looks like a town that you'll see here in the US. This is Nairobi, Kenya. This is Abuja, Nigeria, the capital. This is their main business district. Just to highlight something to pique your interest of what's happening around the world, while we ourselves need to work on building our wealth. I have listed here some of the 10 richest cities in Africa. You can see number 6 is Luanda, Angola. This is where the first slaves came from to the US. We can see that Nairobi, Kenya is on the list, Lagos, Nigeria, Cape Town, South Africa, Cairo, Egypt, Johannesburg, South Africa. So wealth is being developed in Africa as well as it can be here. Traditional ways that we have developed wealth in our communities are through music, sports, some new ways through the internet, the gig economy, and as an entrepreneur. But you must go and get your share. You must go and get your share. Finally, I close by saying a few scriptures that I try to live by and share with my friends and family. Is a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. Proverbs 13:22. And also the rich rule over the poor and the borrower is a slave to the lender. Proverbs 13:22. Wealth will not come to you. You must go and get it. Wealth is created when preparation meets opportunity. Thank you for your time and attention to my presentation. God bless.
Hugh, that was amazing. The history on generation connection.